Welcome back to the second episode of the Inventory System tutorial. We will first open our Blueprint component via the content browser. Our inventory system should be multiplayer capable. That's why we set the value component replicates under class defaults. Then we select the item slots variable. Set the replication value here to replicated. Now we create a custom event and name it setup slot server. Replication here to run on server. This means that this event is only executed on the server and not on the client. Make it reliable. Next, we drag the slots amount variable here so that we can set its value. Drag this pin to the event function so that we automatically add the node pin. Now we add for loop. Now we need to subtract 1 from the slot amount variable and connect the pin to the for loop last index, baseman. We have to subtract 1 because the array indexes always start at 0. If we add 16 slots and do not subtract 1, we would create 17 slots. Next, we take the item slots variable and drag it into the graph. If we hold down the control key while dragging and release the left mouse button, a get of the variable is automatically created. The same can be done with the alt key. Then a set is created. Now we search for the ADD node, betas. Then we grab this pin and select make s underscore inventory slot. We then create a node with the values from the structure and can use our values. We take the index from the for loop and connect it to the slot index. We create a reference to the component for the inventory ref pin. Select get a reference to self. Hide all unconnected pins for better organization. Move the nodes slightly. We delete the event tick because we don't need it. At event begin play, we call our just created function setup slots server. Connect the slot amount. For better organization, we create a comment. Select all nodes and press the C key, and then type in the name for the comment. Set up inventory slots on server. Next, we add the addItem function. We set this to private so that we cannot call it when calling it from the character blueprint and are forced to call our addItemOnServer event, which is executed on the server. We set the variable item to add with the type s underscore inventory slot as input. Then we add a return value. Name this successfully with the type boolean. Before we can continue with the addItem function, we need another function and name it findEmptySlot. Here we create result as output with the type boolean and slot with the type s underscore inventory slot. Now we make some space. Variable. Drag the variable item slot into the graph and search for the for each loop function. Connect the exec pin. Move it a little again. Now we drag from the loop body to the right. And if you hold down the left mouse button and then press the B key, a branch is automatically created. We connect the true pin to the return node and set the return value to true. Now, we have to check in our for each loop, whether the selected slot is empty or contains an item. As we will also use this check later outside our component, we create a blueprint function library for this purpose. To do this, we go back to our content browser and create a new folder with the name library. Open it, right-click on Blueprint, and then select Blueprint Function Library. Call this BFL underscore inventory. BFL stands for Blueprint Function Library. Open it. Blueprint function libraries are a collection of static functions that provide helper functions that are not tied to a specific gameplay object. These libraries can be grouped into logical function sets or contain helper functions that provide access to many different function areas. You can call all of these functions from all blueprints. That's what makes them so great. The first function we create is called isSlotEmpty. Make this a pure function. As input variable, we create slot with the type s_inventoryslot, then an output variable with the name empty as type boolean. Now we make some space again, and what we have to do additionally is to set the input variable as a reference. Now we pull out the pin slot and select break sInventorySlot to be able to access the pins. Unfold it. Take the item data asset pin and check whether it is a valid soft object reference or not. This allows us to recognize whether there is an item in our slot or not. Hide unnecessary pins for a better overview. Now we invert the return value of the valid check so that we can return true as the return value for the empty function. To do this, we select not boolean. Connect the pin to the empty return value. Next, we duplicate this function and rename it isSlotNotEmpty. Select the unnecessary nodes and delete them. Now select the isSlotEmpty function and drag it to the input slot pin in the diagram. Apply the notBoolean function again and connect it to the empty return value. Rename the return value empty to notEmpty. Make sure you are working with the correct isSlotNotEmpty function. Compile and save, and we return to our inventory component. Here, we can now take the pin out of the array element and access our created function isSlotEmpty from the blueprint library function. We now connect the return value to our branch and the slot array element from the forEach loop to the return value slot. Make a few additional nodes and move the nodes around a bit for a better overview. Compile and save again. Now we go back to our addItem function and continue from there. We make some space again and call our newly created function findEmptySlot. We drag the result node out and press B again to create a branch. Connect the nodes. Now if the branch returns false, it means that there are no more free slots, and we print string to do. Inventory is full. Move the return node up and connect it. This returns false as a return value. Next, we need a new function again. We create it and name it setItem. We mark this function as private. Create two input variables. The first, we name targetSlot as type inventorySlot. The second, input value, we name item with the same type. Now we drag the variable itemSlots into the graph and look for the function setArrayElem. This allows us to write values into our array based on the array index. Connect the whole thing with some space in between. Make a break on the target slot and select only the value slot index in the upper right corner because we don't need the others. Connect the slot index to the index and the item pin to the item pin at setArrayElem. This writes our new item into our target slot. Next, we have to update two values in the slot we just set. We do this by reading from the item slots with getAref again. Note that it is important that you call the getAref function so that you can edit the element directly. We connect the slot index so that get knows which element we are editing. Then we drag the pin and search for setMember in sInventorySlot. In the top right corner, we can now specify which values we want to set. In our case, it is slotIndex and inventoryRef. We first connect the slot index and lastly the self-reference to inventoryRef. Next, we create an event dispatcher so that we can always react to changes in a slot later outside of the component. In the top right, we create a return value when the event is triggered. We call the parameter slot, and it is of the type sInventorySlot. Now we drag the event dispatcher into the graph and select call. This will trigger the event. Connect it to the return value. This would finish our add item function. Compile and save again. We go back to the add item function and can continue here. If we have found an empty slot, we then call our set item function. Connect the slot to the target slot. Right click and search for the variable item to add. This is how we call the input value of our add item function. We can recognize this by the small plus F. We could also connect the input value directly, but this way it is clearer. Can you calls? It is important to know that the small plus F is only displayed in Unreal Engine version 5.5 and later. Compile and save, and we go back to the event graph and create a new custom event called add item to server. Call the private add item function. Drag the item to add pin to the event function and thus automatically create the input parameter. We make the add item server function a server function and reliable. To make it easier to see which functions are private or public, we can click on the cogwheel here and select Show Access Specifier in the My Blueprint view. Now it is displayed which functions are private or public. Compile and save, and we can go to our BP underscore third person character and try it out. First, we clear something out. We highlight all these nodes, right click and select Collapse Nodes to create a category and pack it all up. Call it Input Mapping. It looks neater now. For our test purpose, we create a debug key T. Take our inventory component and call the function addItemServer. Now we just have to specify which item we want to add. To avoid having to repeatedly make a makeSInventory slot, and to simplify it, we create an extra function for this in our Blueprint function library. We open this and create the function called makeItemToAdd. As input values, we create itemDataAsset of type PDAItemData and select Soft Object Reference. Make sure to remove the reference here. Then the value quantity of type integer. We now pull out the item data asset pin and search for load asset blocking. This loads our reference into memory. After loading, the engine does not know which object it is. To avoid a cast, we create an interface to retrieve the data directly from the PDA item data asset. We go to the content browser and create a new folder called interfaces again. In that folder, create a new Blueprint Interfaces, which can be found under the menu item, Blueprint. We name our interface BPI underscore assets. BPI stands for Blueprint Interface. Open it. A Blueprint Interface is a collection of one or more functions, name only, no implementation, that can be added to other blueprints. Any blueprint that has the interface added is guaranteed to have those functions for us. The functions of the interface can be given functionality in each of the blueprints that added it. This is essentially like the concept of an interface in general programming, which allows multiple different types of objects to all share and be accessed through a common interface. Put simply, blueprint interfaces allow different blueprints to share with and send data to one another. First, we create the function getItemID with the return value ID of type name. Second, we create the function getItemAsset. We can also sort the functions by simply moving the desired function to where we want it. As a return value, we create itemAsset of type PDA underscore item underscore data, and this time as object reference and not as soft object reference. Finally, create the interface function isItemStackable. As a return value, we create isStackable of type Boolean and stack size of type integer. Click on Compile and Save, and we can close the file because we don't need more for our interface. Now we have to implement the interface in our PDA underscore item data. We open it. Then we go to Class Settings, and here on the right we can add our interface. We click on Add and search for BPI underscore assets. That's it. Our interface is implemented, and we can now see the functions that our interface provides on the left. We just have to set these up. We start with Get Item ID. Double-click on it, and you will see the function where we cannot change any input or output parameters, as these are predefined by the interface. We use our item ID as the return value for ID. Next, we open the Get Item Asset interface and set self as the return value. Finally, we open Is Item Stackable and connect the pins to the corresponding return values. Compile and save, and we're done. We go back to our makeItemToAdd function, and now we can access the values we need based on the interface we created for the unknown object we loaded. In our case, we only need getItemID to read out the ID of the item we are creating. Message in brackets means that the function is an interface from BPI underscore assets. Now we add a return node, which should return the created item slot of type S inventory slot. We make a break on it and hide all the pins we don't need. Connect the ID with item ID, quantity to quantity, and item data asset to item data asset. A few more nodes for a better overview, and we're done. Compile and save. Back in the This Person Character blueprint, we can now drag item to add out and call up our newly created function, make item to add. We forgot to mark this function as a pure function, so let's go back and mark it as pure. Compile and save, and back to the character blueprint, and now we see that the function can be called up directly without any connections. Now we can select the item we want to add. We only have the item DA stone at the moment. We want to have the stone 10 times in our inventory. Compile and save, and we can test it now. Before we start, we will change the net mode to play as listen server. This way, we tell the editor to simulate the whole thing as a server and client. Additionally, we change the play mode so that it is always opened in the new editor window. To see something, we go to debug and click on Blueprint Debugger. Make sure you have the BP underscore third person character open. Then a new window will appear. If we now press play, we can see in the debug window that something has changed. We can open it and see the current state of our blueprint. We see our component with the current values. If we now press the T key in the game, the array content of index 0 is written with our item. If we press T a few more times, more entries are added. That we can now add items to our inventory. It may seem complicated at first, but the more you work with it, the easier it will be in the end. In our next video, we will start creating the widgets to visually display the items directly in the game. I hope you enjoyed this episode, and above all, found it helpful. See you in the next episode.